Hi there. In this video, we're going to look at transition metal ionic compounds and how we write the names for those. Stay in focus. There we go. All right. So when you're naming ionic compounds, typically you just need to write out the name of the metal and the name of the nonmetal with an IDE ending or the name of the polyatomic ion. So I got my list of polyatomic ions. Anytime you're practicing this, you want to make sure you have your list of polyatomic ions handy, as well as your periodic table where you can kind of figure out what the charges are for those different substances or for those different ions that you have in here. But the problem with the transition elements, move my pen here a little bit. The problem with the transition elements, those are the ones in the center here, they don't always have the same charge, unlike things like sodium. Sodium, when it's in a compound, it's always got a plus one charge. Or calcium, when it's in a compound, it's always going to have a plus two charge. Or aluminum, when it's in a compound, it's always going to have a plus three charge. But many of the transition elements have more than one possible charge. For example, copper. Sometimes copper has a plus one charge. Copper can have a plus two charge in other compounds. So it's very much dependent on what substance it happens to be in. And so we see that evidence of that in the name itself. For example, here you can see I have copper with a Roman numeral 1 sulfate and copper with a Roman numeral 2 sulfate. And so those are two different copper compounds. And so we want to look at then, what do those Roman numerals mean? Well, the Roman numeral means it's referring to what the charge is on that copper atom. It's not how many copper atoms there are. It's telling us what the charge is. So it makes it really easy, actually, to write the formula for one of these. And so for copper 1 sulfate, what I like to start off doing, I'll just write out my Cu atom there with a plus 1 charge for that. And then sulfate ion, we can figure out what that is from our list of polyatomic ions. Here's the sulfate ion over on the right-hand side. Sulfate, it's SO4, and it's got a negative 2 charge. So we'll write SO4 with a negative 2 charge. And so when we write out compounds then, or when we write out the formula for this, we want to make sure that the positive charge and the negative charge are equal to each other. Right now, I've got a plus 1 here from the copper and a negative 2 from the sulfate. So I don't have enough positive charge then for this to balance out the negative charge that I have. And so what I need to do then, I need a second copper ion in there. That's now going to give me a total of plus 2. 1 plus 1 gives me a plus 2 to balance out the negative 2 charge. So how I write the formula then for this, it would be Cu2SO4. And that gives me the correct formula. So again, the Roman numeral is telling you what the charge is on each copper atom, not how many copper atoms you're going to have in that formula. So for copper 2 sulfate, we'll do that one over here. Copper 2 then is telling us that the copper ions here have a plus 2 charge. For this, it's the same sulfate ion, so SO4 with a negative 2 charge for this. And so I got a total of plus 2 from the one copper. I have a total of negative 2 from the one sulfate. Here now, those are equal, so I can use just one of each of those atoms. So Cu, or one of each ion, I should say, Cu and then SO4. So that formula there is balanced. So that one is copper 2 sulfate. Again, the 2 is referring to the charge on the copper atom, not how many coppers there are in the formula. All right, so there's our two formulas from the names. All right, and so it's a little tougher then to go the other direction. If we want to go from the name to the formula, let's just erase this here. We want to go from the name to, or from the formula to the name. So let's take a look at FeO and Fe2O3. So two different iron compounds. Both of these are iron oxide. Again, if we use the same rules for naming ionic compounds, again, we name the metal first, or the cation first, iron. And the anion, in this case, the nonmetal, is going to have that IDE ending on it, so oxide there. This one's also iron oxide. I'll leave a little room there because both of these need a Roman numeral to tell what the charge is on each iron atom. So again, there's a little more work that we have to do with these. And so the more work is, we've got to figure out what that charge is. The formula doesn't explicitly tell us. But here's the neat thing. The transition elements are always going to be with another element or another ion where we do know what the charge is. If it's a polyatomic ion, you can just use your list of polyatomic ions to figure that out. If it's a nonmetal ion, like we have here, oxygen's in this column right here. It goes 0, negative 1, negative 2 to get to oxygen's column. So all the oxygen atoms in both of these compounds have that negative 2 charge. So I've got one iron and one oxygen, and we know the oxygen has a negative 2 charge associated with that. And we also know that the positive and negative charges have to equal out. So if I have a total of negative 2 from that one oxygen, I have to get a total of plus 2 from all the iron atoms that I have. Well, I only have one iron atom here, so that one iron has to give me that plus 2 charge. So this is iron with a plus 2 charge, then my name is going to be iron 2 oxide. And if we come over to this one, works the same way. I've got two iron atoms, however, this time. So one, two iron atoms there, and three oxygens. So one, two, three oxygens. We said each oxygen, just like over here, each oxygen is going to have a negative 2 charge. So negative 2, negative 2, negative 2. So again, we need the positive and negative charges to equal out here. So I have 2, 4, 6 negative charges. So a total of minus 6 for that. That means I have to get a total of plus 6 then from these two iron atoms. So easy way to do that then, just take that positive charge that you need, divide it by the number of atoms. So I've only got two irons, so we're going to divide that plus 6 charge up over the two irons. That's a plus 3 for each iron atom then. So that means each iron in this has a plus 3 charge. And so we'll write the name for that one as iron 3 oxide. All right, so that's how we go about writing out formulas and writing out names for transition metal ionic compounds.